For our meditations today, and today, the we have three portions, scripture portions. The first portion is found in Numbers chapter 13, verses 1 to 3, and then 17 to 20, and then 25 to 33. So Numbers chapter 13, verses 1 to 3. The Lord said to Moses, "Send some men to explore the land of Canaan, which I am giving to the Israelites. From each ancestral tribe, send one of its leaders." So at the Lord's command, Moses sent them out from the desert of Paran. All of them were leaders of the Israelites. Verses 17 to 20. When Moses sent them to explore Canaan, he said, "Go up through the Negev and on into the hill country. See what the land is like and whether the people who live there are strong or weak, few or many. What kind of land do they live in? Is it good or bad? What kind of towns do they live in? Are they unwalled or fortified? How is the soil? Is it fertile or poor? Are there trees on it or not? Do your best to bring back some of the fruit of the land." Verses 25 to 33. At the end of 40 days, they returned from exploring the land. They came back to Moses and Aaron and the whole Israelite community at Kadesh in the desert of Paran. There they reported to them and the whole assembly and showed them the fruit of the land. They gave Moses this account: "We went into the land to which you send us, and it does flow with milk and honey. Here is its fruit. But the people who live there are powerful, and the cities are fortified and very large. We even saw descendants of Anak there. The Amalekites live in the Negev. The Hittites, Jebusites, and Amorites live in the hill country, and the Canaanites live near the sea and along the Jordan." Then Caleb silenced the people before Moses and said, "We should go up and take possession of the land, for we can certainly do it." But the men who had gone up with him said, "We can't attack those people. They are stronger than we are." And they spread among the Israelites a bad report about the land they had explored. They said, "The land we explored devours those living in it. All the people we saw there are of great size. We saw the Nephilim there. The descendants of Anak comes from the Nephilim. We seem like grasshoppers in our own eyes, and we look the same to them." This incident we just now read was a very important one in the journey from Egypt to Canaan. But unfortunately, this also happens to be one of the saddest incidents in the life of the Israelites, and it made a huge impact. So that's why it's important that we see. So one important thing to realize is that all of them were leaders. 12 tribes, leaders. So you can think of them equivalent to MPs. Okay, so there are, let's say, close to 6 lakhs plus, so let's say close to about 10 or 12 lakh were the people, and 12 leaders, almost 1 per 1 lakh. Now, they were leaders and they were responsible people. And Moses, and the best part is, the verse 1 itself, Lord said, "I am giving it to the Israelites." God already promised it. And why were they then sent? They were sent to do specifics. How is the land? Is it good? What to do? Walls are there, trees are there, all details, small details they were asked to come back. But they were supposed to go with the confidence that God has given it already. What did they do? They came back and gave a very bad report. Now, this, in fact, had a huge impact for all the community, and we'll see what happened. So that's why it is such an incident which finally brought in very strong judgment on the whole community. Now, unfortunately, yes, whatever they said were true. Their fears were genuine. They were small. Yes, they were grasshoppers in the sight of the other strong people. But one thing they forgot, that 2 years had already passed. And daily they were eating manna. This very day morning they would have eaten manna. And two chapters before, if you see this, God provided them quail in desert. Even Moses thought God can do it. They were seeing God's provision on a daily basis, and there were cloud and shadow. I mean, impossible. So they had no business in not trusting the Lord. That's why God was so upset. Let's see what happened because of this bad report. What happened? This we'll read from Numbers chapter 14, verses 1 to 12. That night, all the people of the community raised their voices and wept aloud. All the Israelites grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole assembly said to them, "If only we had died in Egypt or in this desert. Why is the Lord bringing us to this land only to let us fall by the sword? Our wives and children will be taken as plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt?" And they said to each other, "We should choose a leader and go back to Egypt." Then Moses and Aaron fell face down in front of the whole Israelite assembly gathered there. Joshua son of Nun and Caleb son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had explored the land, tore their clothes and said to the entire Israelite assembly, "The land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will lead us into the land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and will give it to us. Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we will swallow them up. Their protection is gone, but the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid of them." But the whole assembly talked about stoning them. Then the glory of the Lord appeared at the tent of meeting to all the Israelites. The Lord said to Moses, "How long will these people treat me with contempt? How long will they refuse to believe in me? In spite of all the miraculous signs I have performed among them, I will strike them down with a plague and destroy them. But I will make you into a nation greater and stronger than they." So we read just now the impact of these leaders who are responsible people bringing such a bad report. In the process, what they did was they discouraged the whole community. In fact, in the book of Joshua, when Caleb remembers this later, he says that these leaders made the whole community literally melt in fear. Now that kind of impact is what these leaders, good or a bad leader, can do. And a bad leader can bring that much damage. They were afraid, they were rebelled, and they were even planning to go back to slavery. The Lord was very much grieved. We just now read, Lord said that they treated the Lord with contempt. They were not willing to believe, even though God had guided them on a daily basis. Now, as we said, they were eating manna daily. At least that they should have remembered. Now, in Hebrew, Hebrews chapter 3, reads like, one of the verses reads like this, that we should be careful having a sinful, unbelieving heart turning away from the living God. Their problem was, yes, they had, their anxiety was genuine, their fear was genuine, but what they forgot, what the Lord did to them all these years. That's a similar thing can happen to us also when we go through. But if we dwell on that kind of an unbelief for a long time, then that can lead to hardening of hearts. And then God cannot work. That's exactly what is happening here. Their fear, because they did not deal with it, it led to hardening of heart. Unbelief leads to hardening of our hearts. But also we see wonderful examples of good leaders. This Caleb, Joshua, Moses, and Aaron. And we see that Caleb and Joshua were almost stoned for exercising their faith. But we see it's very interesting. They were not afraid. They stood their ground and they encouraged the community in spite of all this opposition, even though they were in a big minority. Now, let's see the remaining, the third portion, how Moses intercedes for the community and also the Lord's judgment on the community. This we find in, I will not read the whole portion. Let's read chapter 14, Numbers chapter 14, 19 to 23. Verses 19 to 23. 19 starts like this. In accordance with your great love, forgive the sin of these people, just as you have pardoned them from the time they left Egypt until now. The Lord replied, I have forgiven them as you asked. Nevertheless, as surely as I live, and as surely as the glory of the Lord fills the whole earth, not one of the men who saw my glory and the miraculous signs I performed in Egypt and in the desert, but who disobeyed me and tested me 10 times, not one of them will ever see the land I promised on oath to their forefathers. No one who has treated me with contempt will ever see it. So we see a very strong condemnation and judgment coming on the whole community. And we read, if you read the remaining portion, God said none of them would enter Canaan. And which means they had to, the 2 years are over, the remaining 38 years they had to go round and round in the desert till the last person among this generation, the older ones about age of 20 were dead. And that is a very strong judgment. So the Lord heard Moses' prayer. God forgave them, but they had to live with the consequence of their disobedience. This is something, a warning for us too. But at the same time, let's read verse 24. God's encouragement also, this Caleb who stood his ground. Verse 24 reads, But because my servant Caleb has a different spirit and follows me wholeheartedly, I will bring him into the land he went to, and his descendants will inherit it. What a wonderful promise in the midst of the whole community. Now this man, but did Caleb inherit the land? Yes. It's interesting to read. If you just turn to Joshua chapter 14, very, very interesting. Now what I liked most about this part was in that particular, in Joshua 14, Caleb recalls, he tells to Joshua this past incident, and he tells that I was 40 at that time, and then he says 45 years have passed. But I like this particular, so his age is now 85. Okay, how do you think about a man at age 85? But read, let's see what he says in Joshua chapter 14. Verse 11, he says, I am still as strong today as the day Moses sent me out. I am just as vigorous to go out to battle now as I was then. What a man. What is the reason? Do you think he was, he had some, you know, extraordinary fitness or something? No, I don't think so. The difference was, he knew Lord was with him. And I think that's what makes the difference. Whatever problems we go through, big or small, the difference is if we look at our own resources and our own way of solving it, we will fail. The difference Caleb had was he was able to wholeheartedly follow the Lord and he trusted God. Now the second judgment is even more painful, which you read in verse 33. Very, very painful. This I'm not reading the whole portion, just the last part. Your children will be shepherds here for 40 years, suffering for your unfaithfulness until the last of your bodies lies in the desert. The sad part is, the worst thing that can happen is not just us, but even our children suffering because of our unfaithfulness. I think that's too strong. And I think that's something we should watch out for. The title of my message today was passing on faith to our children and to our dear ones. Whether we like it or not, we are actually impacting others. So from this portion, from this incident, we can think of at least three major lessons. when we face a crisis, and we will throughout our life, okay, on a daily basis, we will face smaller or bigger crisis. What should be our response? One way is to, you know, get into anxiety and so much of depression and going through. Or do we trust in God, look back and see what God did in our lives? And that's exactly what God expects from us, that we at least recollect, go back and think what the Lord did in our lives. Psalm 103, 1 and 2 reads like this: Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Sometimes we can be so obsessed with the material things and easily forget to be faithful to God and to live in obedience to God. So let's remember, next time when we face a crisis, you know, it will either make us go forward or it will take us backwards. The second one, the need for good leaders. You see, out of these 12 leaders there are only two who really trusted, even though all the 12 of them had experienced God's mercy, God's grace, God's provision. Only 12, out of only them, only two stood the ground, and they were an example. Whether we believe it or not, all of us sitting here are leaders. Okay, what is the definition of a leader? Leader is somebody who impacts others. We may be impacting others in a big way or in a small way, maybe in our homes, maybe in our places of work, but whatever way, all of us sitting here, we have our spheres of impact. We need to be very careful. We are either encouraging people or we are discouraging. We are either building people or we are bringing them down. I want to read Hebrews 3, 12 and 13, which I just referred a little bit ago. What an encouragement can do. Hebrews chapter 3, 12 and 13 reads like this: See to it, brothers, that none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God, but encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. Let me repeat that verse 13 again: But encourage one another daily, as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. Very seldom we receive encouragement, but we all have our share of discouragements on a daily basis. But let's be encouragers. That's in our hand. We can encourage others to go forward. Be an encourager. Thirdly, what kind of legacy are we leaving behind for our children and for our future generation? As parents, we are definitely concerned about our children's future, their education, you know, their placement and so on. Nothing wrong about it. But is that all? Even more important is to instill in our children faith in a living God and a genuine love for it. And it's extremely important to remember that our children, whether we like it or not, are copying us. If we are men and women of faith, they will have that. If we are not, they will not have it. So therefore, we have a huge impact, especially in our families. And we could influence our children and those in our spheres of influence positively for living for God, or discourage them or be a hindrance to them. So let's take the warning from this incident and let's be like Caleb, who trusted God wholeheartedly and was not easily moved by the crises that came on his way. In closing, I want to read two verses which encourages me a lot. Philippians 4, 6 and 7 is a verse worth remembering and memorizing on a daily basis. We need Philippians 4, 6 and 7. It reads like this: Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. The second verse I want to share is Colossians 2:6. So then, just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. One thing I liked about both these verses was there is one commonality. And that's this word thankfulness. And I believe a thankful spirit would go a long way in trusting God. And so when we face problems in life, let's always be thankful to the Lord, what the Lord did in our lives. And that to take us forward. And let's be people who really influence others to go forward in their faith in the Lord. Shall we pray? Oh Lord, our loving Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word. And Lord, how, Lord, this you have recorded, Lord, these incidents for us to challenge us, to inspire us, to warn us. Lord, we thank you for all that you have done in our lives all these years. Lord, we pray that when we face different kinds of problems every day, help us, Lord, to remember what you did in our lives and not to allow disbelief to overpower us. Instead, Lord, we pray that your spirit would empower us, Lord, to trust in you and to go forward so that, Lord, we would be people of influence. Help us, Lord, to be people of influence, those who encourage others and influence others in a positive way. Help us, Lord, in our walk as we go out of this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.